Well, I just think I'd feel much better about it if we could lock down a great representation visually of what my brand is.
Okay, so how exactly would you describe your brand?
It's like aesthetically or cinematographically, if that's a word.
It's not.
I feel like it's everything you loved about the classic movies of our childhood, like Sandlot, Billy Madison, Apocalypse Now, Happy Gilmore, Clueless. But at the same time, I feel like my brand is not rooted in the past. It's actually very forward thinking and like futuristic.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, imagine like what 2090 is like, but like it's being described by someone who's from 1920.
TBTL. Guess what day it is? Guess what day it is?
It's Friday. Friday. Gotta get down on Friday. Everybody's looking forward to the weekend.
So I'm what's known as a psychic medium, but I'm also clairsentient, which means that I feel my angels. I'm also clairvoyant, which means I can see. I'm also clairaudient, which is most of the time I actually hear. I hear voices. And I also do financial advising.
I'm not handling this well. I don't feel competent. I'm depressed.
It's kind of weird. I feel like I'm being interrogated, but by someone who doesn't really want to know anything important.
All right. Hello, good morning, and welcome, everyone, to a Friday edition of TBTL, the show that just might be too beautiful to live.
It's like someone punching your brain, but in a weirdly satisfying way.
My name is Luke Burbank. I am your host, coming to you once again from the corner of 47th and Broadway in New York City.
You really are the most devious bastard in New York City.
Where it is snowing right now. And as of the moment, as of this recording, it's not sticking to the streets, but it is definitely starting to come down. And we'll see where things go. We'll see if we're able to get out of here tomorrow when it's time for our flight. But for now, it's warm and dry here inside the hotel, and we're ready to do the show.
Another day, another victory for the OG. Taking down the sweats, the imposters among us.
In this case, the OG would be the Olive Garden, which I'm watching a continuous loop of three large video screens showing me Olive Garden food. And I am not going to lie to you. I don't know if it's Stockholm Syndrome or just the fact that I haven't had anything to eat yet today. But they've got me. The salad, just the way that they're pouring that Olive Garden, that classic Olive Garden salad dressing in slow-mo over a salad with big, unnaturally large black olives in it. It's working. Another victory for the OG. Here we are in Times Square, also right near Broadway. I saw Hamilton last night.
I'm the president of rap music, and I need to work with you right away.
I had an interesting experience, actually, which we'll talk about today on the program. A program, by the way, which arrives at episode 4,123 in a collector's
Let
series.
Let the fun begin.
We'll also try to talk about Chad Face. What is it, and how can you avoid it here in 2024?
Your face. Who are you facing?
Oh, and speaking of the video screens here in Times Square that I'm staring at, there's one that is really causing me to want to do something that I know will probably annoy Andrew.
Hey, want to hear the most annoying sound in the world?
But I am fighting it. I may lose the battle, though, before the episode is done today. Speaking of my friend Andrew, he is the longest-running Cobro of the show, maybe best known for his depictions of the tall ships. He doesn't know this, but I've actually installed a series of hidden microphones in his studio, and this is actual tape of him getting ready for the show each morning. He's joining me right now. Good morning, my friend.
Hey, Luke. I know you have a lot of adventures from New York, but I just saw something that is blowing my mind. As a 47-year-old, Okay, let me pose it as a question. As somebody who was born in 1976, that's me. I was the one born in 1976 and grew up in the 80s and early 90s. And by the way, nobody's giving me a hard time about this except for me. I'm curious, do you think it's fair or reasonable for me to confuse Suzanne Summers with Sally Struthers? Because I am just now realizing, after getting an email from a listener, that I may have been using those two names interchangeably my entire life. I know now that I see them in front of me that we're talking about two different people. Two, I think,
blonde-haired women.
Yes.
With names that begin with S for first and last name. Yeah, they both have
alliterative names. Blonde hair. They were both pretty big in the same kind of era, the 80s. I don't think it's at all. In fact, I would bet you that a lot of people make that mistake. They're kind of the Dermot Mulroney and Dylan McDermott of their kind of scene. You know what I mean? Very similar people and easily confused. I don't think this is on you.
Derek McDomdom. That's just a name I made up to throw it in the mix. Yeah, but this came up. Do you remember why it came up? I think it was yesterday or the day
before.
You
mentioned Suzanne Summers, and I said she and her husband were quite in love, and her husband thinks that he's haunted by her ghost. And now I'm wondering, did you think the whole time that the husband of the lady from Save the Children was being haunted by her ghost? I don't think Sally Struthers has passed, actually.
What if Suzanne Summers is haunting Sally Struthers' husband? I think I said something like, do you want to make more money or something? And I can't hear that phrase without thinking of this commercial from the 90s.
Do you want to make more money? Sure, we all do.
And that's just lives
definitely
in my brain.
Sally Struthers.
That is Dylan McDoodoo. No, that is indeed. That is. And I got an email from a listener says, I think you're thinking of Sally Struthers. There's no other context. I was like, that is who I was thinking of. And honestly, like, as you're reading the intro, or not reading, as you're doing your intro to the show, I'm like, wait, how long have I just been saying one name instead of the other? I've never held the two concepts of both Sally Struthers and Suzanne Summers in my head at the same time.
You've never held those truths to be self-evident. Sorry, I've still got a lot of Hamilton going in my brain.
Oh, yeah, no kidding. I was wrapped the musical.
They gave me that bass, that big, big bass in my face. Back quickly to the Sally Struthers, Susan Summers thing. The reason that when you said something about make money and I just went with it was because, well, Suzanne Summers became very famous for the Thigh Master.
Yeah.
And the story was that she was actually a very savvy business person. And, you know, through like QVC and all these different things, she had become quite the mogul, I believe. And so it just seemed like you were saying something about Suzanne Summers' post Three's Company business acumen. But I did not realize that Sally Struthers, who I think was in All in the Family, right? She's the daughter in All in the Family.
I can confirm that now because I'm putting it all together by looking at their Wikipedia pages. But you're right. She was the daughter in All in the Family. She also was in that. She did voices. I heard voices, and they were her voice. She was on that TV show Dinosaurs, Not the Mama.
Was she the baby dinosaur?
She played Charlene Sinclair. I don't remember the cast of that show well enough or the characters of that show. She played Pebbles in the TV show Pebbles and Bam Bam, the Flintstone, Pebbles Flintstone.
Wow, she really had kind of an era, a sort of of Earth's history that she was really leaning into between dinosaurs and the Flintstones.
Yeah,
like, and then it was real cave people. Although the cave people and the dinosaurs did not live together. I want to be clear about
that. Are you sure?
I know that much.
I heard something on Brock and Salk that would beg to differ.
I'm going all over the map today, Andrew, because it's a Friday and I can do whatever I want. We ain't got to work tomorrow. I get to do whatever I want. And one thing I'll tell you, I began the week promoting something that I never got to, but this is as good a time as any, which is I have gotten really into turning on the Bluetooth on my television and running it through my big oversized Apple AirPod Max headphones.
Yeah, I love that move.
And watching Nova, the science program on, I'm not high, by the way. This sounds like the most high person behavior of all time, but Nova has this great series about the kind of history of the solar system and the Earth and, you know, just obviously very much sort of abridged and, condensed and made graspable for nimrods like me. But sitting on my couch with those headphones on and just like listening to the thing, it's so immersive. And I know this is something that everybody has been doing. I have never connected wireless headphones to my television, and I never want to go back. I never want to go back to just listening to the TV on the external speaker or whatever. It's like I'm at a movie or something. It's so cool.
And it's convenient. I mean, I know this is a very different, this serves a very different purpose for me, but maybe I'm even making the argument for lack of immersive. But for me, like if I'm coming downstairs, putting on headphones on the television will sort of both allow me to wander a little bit if I need to, but still stay focused on what's going on. I don't know what you would diagnose it as, but I definitely have issues with paying attention to the television. I just get like kind of antsy. And there's something about having it strapped right to my head that just makes me feel like I can sort of consume it.
You're
easier.
Taking it with you.
Yeah.
You're kind of turning, it sounds like you're sort of turning the TV watching experience into a more portable experience. It's almost half radio show, half television.
Which makes it, and that makes it sound like I'm always away from the TV, but it's not that so much as like maybe I'll be folding clothes downstairs and then, you know, my clothes also, I keep them down here too. So I'll like fold clothes in front of the TV, then maybe walk behind the TV for a second to put some t-shirts away in my little locker or whatever. So I'm like, I'm always hovering around the TV. I'm not just like kind of upstairs eating a bologna sandwich, listening
well,
to Malcolm in the middle downstairs.
Sally Struthers and Suzanne Summers. You're not making a strong argument that you're in the room with the television.
But that was before all of this technology.
It really was.
I will say this. I know that we get into this topic kind of a lot, and there are more interesting and more informed people to talk about it than me. But, like, honestly, there is something about Bluetooth, and, you know, maybe for the past, I don't know, when Genevieve and I got this new TV, which is about a year old, is when I started, like, hooking my headphones up to it. It really does blur the lines between television and movie. And it basically blurs the line between my television and my iPad and my phone, right? It basically makes my television like a big fancy tablet, sort of, with a bunch of apps on it. Because, again, I'm not watching cable. I have a bunch of apps like Netflix and HBO and what have you. I have it on my phone. I have it on my tablet.
Right.
I have it on my television. I can listen to them all through wireless, you know, earbuds or earphones.
It's just a screen.
Yeah.
It's just a different size screen that's bringing, which has, you know, been probably the plan and the dream of the content creators and even the technology companies.
No, I'm afraid I just blew myself.
Like, to just create, yeah, you just have all these different sized, you know, kind of windows through which you can look at whatever the content is, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, I've seen these ads now. I hope I don't buy this, Andrew, because I don't need it in my life at all, but I saw the ad for it and I was like, that is intriguing. And it's just basically like a flat screen monitor that is, you know, exactly what you're describing. I don't think it even works as a television that would, you know, connect to your cable necessarily, but it's just something you can, you know, screen share with on your phone or whatever. And it's on a rolling little cart.
Oh.
And it rotates. So it's a rectangle, but I think you can rotate it so that it's basically landscape mode or like up and down mode.
Okay.
It wheels
yeah.
around and you yeah. like, let's say, you know, I'm somebody that when I cook, I usually mm-hmm. have printed out a text message from Becca that's telling me how to make the thing.
Mm-hmm.
I will print it out and I will pin it to the cabinet because the kitchen that I use is soon to be demolished. So I'm like, whatever. But like, because I'm the kind of person that if I cook, I kind of usually need a recipe and I need to be referring to it a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I wheel that screen in. I've got the New York Times cooking blog up. I'm looking at it. There's something, what they did was made a very compelling use case to me on this video that I saw. Now, do I need this in my life? No. Like you, I have a lot of screens. I have a phone that is a screen. I have an iPad that I haven't used in 5 years. There's an iPad sitting in the Madrona Hill studio doing God knows what, because of course I acquired it when they came out and it just isn't something that really I use in my life. I don't need another screen, but I was intrigued by this little screen that you roll around with you.
I am intrigued by that too. I haven't seen it. I'm just picturing it based on what you've told me, and I'm picturing it very like kind of modern, sleek, minimalist
yep,
design.
Yep, yep.
Now, how about this, Luke? How about we fast forward to the point where that technology is combined with both like your smart speaker technology and your Roomba technology, so you can just give that guy a name, let's say mm-hmm. McDoodoo, and you can just say,
yeah.
"Well, no, you don't want Doodoo in the kitchen. Sorry. Let's
no.
just what's a good name for
Disgusting.
A robot? Yeah, whatever. Hey, Tabby, mm-hmm. come on." In here in the kitchen, we're going to do some cooking, and that little thing rolls up behind you and then spins so that it's like the right dimensions for your task at hand.
Well, Andrew, that's another thing that I need you to hold me accountable to not buy, please.
Oh, no.
There is this, you know, that robot that Amazon, it was at like whatever CES a couple of years ago. By the way, the stand that I saw is, I believe, made by LG. And it's called the Stand By Me.
Okay.
It's kind of a clever yep. name. And it's exactly as you described. It's a very sleek design, and it's just a thing that you bring around that just, It's like a giant iPad on a stand, but then you can have all of your content there.
Oh, now, and it comes in a metal briefcase that you can carry around like a high-power criminal?
That's another one. I think that's not... I've seen that as well. That's not the one I was thinking of, but that is also really...
They're both called Stand By Me's. I see there's different maybe models. Okay.
I have seen the briefcase one, and again, I'm like, I don't need to carry a briefcase of television with me.
Yeah, you do, though.
But growing up, the idea of a briefcase... with something in it that you, I don't know why that's like, you know, the male need to dig a hole.
The masculine urge
to carry a briefcase around, a suitcase around that has television in it. I saw somebody on some online platform with this Amazon Astro, which is this robot, you know, so-called robot made by Amazon that is kind of almost, my guess is it does almost exactly what you just described. It's on wheels. It's got we'll call it an iPad for a face, but really it's like a tablet. It's, you know, it's a security system. It'll distract your pets. It'll follow you around and tell you things if you need them. It's basically like an Amazon, it's like an Alexa that can like, you'd be like, hey, get in here. And it can come into the room and like do whatever you want. And it's the kind of thing that I just don't need in my life. But again, what happens is I'll just see a clip and the people putting the clip together will have done a very effective job of creating a scenario that I think, well, what if I'm in that scenario? Won't this be helpful? This thing is freaking $1,600. And I don't think you can even buy it. It says available exclusively by invitation. I think you have to ask to get you have to stand there in a long line to get to a velvet rope to be allowed to spend $1,600 on an iPad on wheels. But the reason I know this is because I went to the website to go, oh, how much is that thing? And it turns out way too expensive and way not worth it. But it's basically what you described. It's kind of you could say autonomous, or at least a mobile version of this that can drive itself into the room you're in and do whatever it is you're asking it to do, supposedly.
I don't know if this is the same thing, but when I typed in iPad on wheels, first of all, the design, what is the brand that you're talking about?
This is made by the Amazon.
Okay. I need to take a look at that. So that's probably my mistake. So I have a bunch of things here that is called up that are less like kind of cute looking and a little bit more industrial and a little bit more intimidating because it looks like the main use for quote unquote an iPad on wheels is like, and you've seen these in like, whoa. What kind of businesses use these? I don't know. But like, I swear we've seen use cases where like you're walking down a hallway at work when people still went to places to work. And then the boss would roll up and it's just their head on an iPad.
Well, they did an interview with like Edward Snowden that way once, I think, back in the day.
Yes,
right?
Yes, exactly. And like there's something very creepy about what I'm looking at here.
Right. No, I know what you mean. And this is, I'm trying to. I took a picture of this thing. It's called Astro, and I'm trying to send it to you right now.
There it is.
Do you see it? It's the irony, Andrew.
Oh, this guy's cute. Okay,
it's cute as all hell.
Yeah. Like it stays close to the ground. It doesn't have a long spindly arm, or does it shoot something up? It looks more like
shoots webs.
Okay, it's like
those are proprietary Amazon technology. So what they'll do is they'll put you on a schedule where it auto delivers new webs every month.
Nice.
So you don't ever have to remember to refill your Astro webs. It'll just always have good wet webs ready to go.
I can't shoot web. I'm out of fuchsia web. I'm out of cyan web. I don't need cyan web.
You know that
I just
want to
use black web.
You know that I'm on. They've got me. I'm on the toner delivery system now.
Really? Is your printer just ordering it itself now?
It's trying to. I sort of don't let it, but what I have done for the first time is ordered toner through this terrible company, Amazon, before my printer was out of toner, which is a first for me because it's usually like 5 minutes before the show and I'm trying to print a show sheet and it's like, sorry, we can't do this. The thing is, running out of toner is like running out of gas. They start telling you it's a problem long before it's a critical problem, but when it becomes the critical problem, then you're kind of effed.
And if you like, and obviously I'm not like this, but if you train yourself to think that the first warnings don't mean anything, it's hard to know
when
to start paying attention to it.
Precisely. That's where you get yourself in trouble. Like, you know, for my entire, from 16 to 25, probably, if not longer, I knew exactly how far below E I could go in my various beater cars that I had because of not having any money and because of, just pushing it to the limit. I will say that I've been fortunate that in this phase of my life, that is less of a situation in terms of like, I have enough money to put gas in my car, but I still feel like a Rockefeller when I fill my car, when I fill the tank up. I mean, you also have to be a Rockefeller in this day and age to fill your tank. It's like $70. But when I look at that thing and it's all the way full, I think there was a time in my life when I thought I'll never actually drive a car ever that has a full gas tank in it. Like this is for the 1%. This is for people that are on the invitation list for Amazon Astro.
Do you think I know this is similar to another question I asked you recently, but do you think it's fair and reasonable for a kid who grew up in the 80s and early 90s to confuse fuchsia with magenta? Because I meant magenta there, and I said fuchsia, and I got them
Let
both
me see,
open
can
on
I
different
do this?
Tabs.
Let me see if I can do this, okay? Is fuchsia a pinkish area with points?
It is.
Okay,
yeah,
and then
magenta.
What does that mean magenta is?
It, they look exactly the same to me. I'm going back and forth. I think it's
They're
fair
the
and
Sally
reasonable.
Struthers and Susan Summers of colors.
That's my argument. That's my thesis.
I'll never graduate. It's such a coincidental thing that you would bring up Sally Struthers here on this Friday edition of the program, because last night Becca and I went to get some dinner at a place called Sardi's, which is kind of a legendary Broadway restaurant. I mean, it's sort of exactly what you would expect, I guess, in the food department, which is not great, but it has
is it like old school charm, sort of
super old school. It has, there's probably 300 or 400 caricatures. The walls are covered in caricatures of famous people, Broadway stars.
Yeah.
But the caricatures are mostly terrible. That's the amazing part. So we were just playing a game of like, who do you think that is? Like, because they're not, you know what I mean? Like, you're like, is that Tom Cruise-ish? Like, that's either, you know, like.
It's either Tom Cruise or L. Ron Hubbard.
Exactly. I mean, literally, that would be that was the fun of the game, was kind of like just. And then, you know, there's just these like maybe three layers of these caricatures. And then there's a big one above them. If you've ever been mayor of New York, you get a bigger caricature and you're on this top level. And I noticed we were sitting right by Rudy Giuliani. I was like, is there a mechanism for taking one of these down? Like, what's the,
right.
But there was this one area that was literally just like a yellow aura.
In Maine, they took him down, by
yes.
the way.
Well, we'll see what the Supreme Court has to say about that, my friend. But, there was an area that was just a yellow aura. And I was like, is that Sally Struthers? Mm. They had decided to do Sally Struthers just as a burst of yellow curls and almost no defined facial features. But I figured out it was her because of this angelic golden blonde hair that was everywhere. So,
and you know, it wasn't Suzanne Summers. It was definitely Sally.
I know it
Struthers.
Wasn't because okay. Character did not have a thigh master.
Okay. I actually, Luke, no joke, you describing, I'm on their website, I'm seeing some of these caricatures. It really does raise the question. And this is, I was going to say, no disrespect. There's no way I can ask this question without being disrespectful.
All right, go for it.
Caricature artist, but like, is there such thing as a good caricature? I guess it sort of raises that question. But like, your description of how they did Sally Struthers, actually, I find that to be very compelling and winning.
Is there a picture of that picture?
No, I'm looking for it now. Sorry, yeah. But just I like the impressionistic or
right.
The,
yeah. No, it's definitely clever because if you're going to do, you know, it would be, and somebody has probably done this. The interesting move would be caricatures that are just like you said, impressionistic, like although. The impressionists, that's what, like, Cezanne, those are very those are very literal.
No,
I just mean, like, a vibe. How about this? Let's use that word.
Yeah.
Caricatures that are a vibe.
In essence.
So, in essence. And that'd be a fun game, and maybe it is a game.
Yeah.
Like, somebody who's just created these things that when you look at it, you know what it means, even though it's not, like, they're not trying to draw Jay Leno on a surfboard,
mm-hmm.
you know, hanging 10 or something. Like, there's something woven into it that tells your brain what it's supposed to mean, even though it's very non-literal.
Yeah, I like that. Just like a burst of color, be as a tribute to her locks. I love that.
Yes. So that was Sally Struthers. We did go see a Hamilton last night, and I know that let me put it this way. I think you and I generally are a little bit less amped about the idea of Hamilton than our listeners are.
Yeah, I'm just not a musical guy. Into musicals, yeah.
And I'm generally not either, although what I've realized is I'm very into the musicals that I grew up with. So
oh, yeah,
if
that's true.
Like, you know, The Sound of Music, I love. Fiddler on the Roof, I love. The Music Man, Meet Me in St. Louis. Like, any of the musicals that I watched when I was a kid, I love and I will sing them, you know, with a song in my heart. I'll be very excited about them. It's hard for me as an adult to bring new musicals, to create room in my brain and my heart for new musicals. And the thing with Hamilton for me was there's a sort of a non-self-awareness of a Broadway musical, generally speaking. And that's something that I sometimes have a hard time with. That's, I think, really on me more than anyone else. Like the fact that if something isn't just 100% self-aware all the time and constantly apologizing for its own existence, mm-hmm. I don't vibe with it. Because mm-hmm. that's how I kind of am in the world a lot of the time, is just constantly wanting to let everyone know that I get it. That, you know, this thing I'm doing is not cool, but that I'm in on it. So then please don't judge me. And there's something unapologetic about musicals. Just like, we're just going to start singing and we're going to be totally earnest about this. And that's something that I find kind of challenging. Then you throw in this kind of vaguely hip hop aspect, like kind of, you know, rapping presidents. And then it's just like, it's as you line it up, it's a lot of things. And then just the overall, like, nationwide, at least the nation of people that I tend to hang out with and talk to and love, obsession, that group of people, the obsession with Hamilton, which is to say, generally speaking, white college educated people, the very people Nikki Haley is really trying to reach out to right now in the state of New Hampshire. Basically, like, a lot of the people that are in the world that I hang out in got really obsessed with Hamilton, really obsessed. And that's another thing that usually kind of like turns me off to something, is if everyone else is obsessed with it and I don't get there first, I'm kind of like, we'll see. So I did at some point download the Hamilton soundtrack because I was like, I've heard so much about this. I should at least see what this is all about. And I listened to it having never seen the actual production. And I will say that the music did not immediately arrest me. It did not immediately. I didn't go like, oh, I get it now. In fact, I was kind of like, this sounds like Rap the Musical to me. I will tell you that I found it very affecting last night. Maybe it's just being in the theater with it. Maybe it's the performers were incredibly talented performers. The parts that were the rappiest were the parts I liked the least. But the other parts, the actual songs, the basically everything that wasn't someone rapping about the Constitution, I found...
God, I'd love to read your review. Like, I wish I could go back, like, when was it, like, real? When did it debut? Like, 6, 7 right. years ago?
Luke Burbank writing for Time Out New York?
Yes, I'd love to read this review. Like, it's very good when they're not rapping about the Constitution.
But, like, I was very, I found it very emotionally affecting. First of all, I was really glad that I saw it. And I overall really enjoyed the experience. And I found it to be a really moving thing. And I like I said, I kind of, what I wanted to say was, like, everybody simmer down on the rapping. And everybody just, like, let's keep going with the songs that were not the rap songs were so good. And even the rap songs were, I kind of got into it eventually because, I mean, what they're doing is they're just giving you a bunch of information that could be otherwise pretty dry, and they're just kind of, they're zhuzhing it up. I swear I probably learned some things about U.S. history from it, which is kind of a sad statement on my level of education, that these were things I didn't know before. But, like, I found it actually, so I found it very informative. And I was, you know, I mean, the staging of it was really cool. That's like, has these, because I don't go to a lot of musicals, doesn't occur to me how kind of like, how well they've figured this shit out, right? Like, the stage has these two rotating sections. So the very center of the stage is a big rotating thing, but it's all, you can't really tell from the audience. The stage is just flat, but the middle part is a disc, right? And then there's a wider disc that's outside. And so they can just do this stuff where, like, a character is singing a song and they're thinking about two other characters, and those other characters are moving around them in this circle. Like, visually, it was very, very entertaining, you know?
How and were the caribou, the CGI caribou?
Honestly, it was so much more believable than season 3 of True Detective Great North. By the way, I've been going, there's a, as if I haven't gone hard enough on that product, there's a giant billboard of it, a giant digital billboard of it that's right down the street from where we're staying that I keep seeing. And I want to just stand in front of it and go, not worth your time, everyone.
Can I just mention this? And again, I still haven't seen it. I actually still might watch that first episode because in a certain way, you didn't, it kind of going back to your hypothesis about things being hyped, you didn't overhype it on the show, so you've lowered my expectations, which means I might enjoy it more than I would have going in with the high expectations I was getting from seeing the promos. But I told Veeves, I'm like, oh, you know, we did talk about True Detective on the show. Luke saw it. Now, keep in mind, Veeves has seen it, and she liked the first episode. You saw it, and you didn't. Yeah.
I was curious to, I mean, maybe you mentioned that the other day and I've forgotten it, but yeah, so she did like it.
She did, and I don't know if I did mention that the other day, but I said, oh yeah, well, Luke talked about it, he didn't like it, and she's like, oh, I disagree, I thought it was pretty good, and I'm like, Luke said that the CGI caribou were rough. She's like, oh God, yeah, she's like, I have to admit, yeah, and then she's like, and then I'm like, and the Coke polar bear was in there? She's like, yeah, it was the same thing as the Coke polar bear. I was like, what about
I love that I'm just ruining this for Veeves way of you.
But then I said, what about some of the dialogue between the two detectives? It sounded sort of cringy. She's like, I didn't find it cringy. But anyway, it was funny. She's like, no, I liked it. And I was like, what about the caribou? Ooh, yeah, the caribou. Yeah.
I think that there is actually probably, I don't know if a parallel is the thing I'm trying to say, or some kind of a, there's a through line between these two things, which is both Hamilton and this latest season of True Detective, which is like, you can be a person, it's possible to be a person in the world, and not, Genevieve has, I think, one of the more discerning brains and sets of eyes of anybody that I know. I mean, Genevieve can size something up really fast and really accurately. But, like, there's a way of going through the world where it's like, yeah, okay, every line wasn't perfect, but I don't have to, we have to throw this entire baby and bathwater out. Like, okay, they said a couple corny lines. Like, in fact, when we were talking about The Sopranos, you and I both agree that the scenes with the kids are rough.
Yeah, I remember thinking, you know, that even at the time. I think it's
but
tough.
I don't like, I did, it didn't mean that I'd never, like, I watched one episode of The Sopranos and it was like AJ said a corny line and then I was, or Meadow said a corny line and I was just like, okay, done with this show. But I'm applying that standard to True Detective. There was like some bad CGI and then there was literally two lines that were rough for me. And that's, so now this entire production has no possible value to me. Or like the Hamilton thing, like, okay, I think that I mean, the great irony is I'm so, so far from being a person who really knows about whatever passes for hip hop now. You know what I mean? Like, and I, when I say passes for hip hop, I don't mean that as a slam. I mean, I don't even know if we're referring to it as hip hop anymore.
The fact that you're referring to it as a slam means that you're familiar with an earlier era of hip hop.
Yes. The band Onyx. Slam. Let the boys be like. The idea that I think I'm above Hamilton because I know more about, again, a genre of music that may not even be called hip hop anymore is kind of is a pretty sad commentary on me. And what I found myself feeling at the end of that production last night was very emotionally moved and very glad that I had seen it. And, you know, once is probably enough for me. I don't think I'll probably be jogging to the soundtrack. I also really identified with the King George character, which is bad because he's the bad guy in it. But that guy is, they just,
well, don't spoil it.
They have a very clever device. I love that I'm describing Hamilton to a group of people. You're the only person who's hearing this who hasn't seen Hamilton.
It is 2024.
Until yesterday, you and I were the last two people in America who had not seen Hamilton, and now only you have not seen Hamilton. But
I love that, like, we're going to drop a podcast today on January 19th, the year of our Lord, 2024, and the description is going to be Luke Reviews Hamilton.
But, like, if there is a song from the soundtrack that I would listen to on repeat, it's literally the song that they have King George kind of sing. I mean, what's very clever about this production is the people who made it are obviously very steeped in the popular music of the last 20 years. So the songs are not parodies in any sense, but they are like those caricatures you and I are talking about. They're like a vibe.
Mm-hmm.
And what they've done is very cleverly created this song that King George kind of comes out of nowhere and sings that feels like a song that you've heard, but it's not. but it feels like a kind of song that you might remember from the 90s or something, where someone loves someone, but they're obviously really shitty to the person. And the idea being that King George is like, you know, hey, you're my subjects and I love you so much that I'm going to kill all of you if you don't love me. But it's very funny the way it's delivered. And he keeps coming out at different times. And he's very much the comic relief of the show, because pretty much everything else is pretty serious and earnest and people are not going to miss their shot or whatever the big song is. He's like the only thing that's just objectively funny about it. But I'm also, essentially, so I said to Becca, I was like, that's my favorite character. She goes, you know, that's the bad guy in the show. And she mentioned someone else that we know who had also said it was their favorite character. And I was like, let me rethink my answer on this one, please.
Well, I mean, your favorite character is the Grinch, I believe, from most
Well, I mean, honestly,
movies.
Isn't the Grinch the best part of that whole thing?
I mean, definitely the character has more contours, I would say.
I think there's actually probably a fairly long history of whoever the villain is, the baddie, being actually the most interesting character in, you know, in whatever the thing.
Yeah,
is.
I don't. It can't be an accident that we're talking about The Sopranos here. I mean, yeah. Like, I mean, in Breaking Bad, I mean, I think our culture obviously has always played around with that. I think honestly, the 2000s, we've seen a real rise of the anti-hero, right? I mean, those two huge examples right there, Walter White in Breaking Bad and Tony Soprano.
Right.
But even like, you know, oh God. All right, I started the thought. I'll finish it. But, like, do you remember when
Loretta Swit from MASH. That's who you're thinking of.
Is that who played, what was her name?
Hot Lips?
Hot Lips. I was going to say Kissy Bones, which I knew that was wrong.
On today's episode, Luke reviews Kissy Bones.
Hot Lips, Kissy Bones. Say, do you know, is it reasonable for a kid who grew up in the 80s to confuse Hot Lips with Kissy Bones? What is the name of the guy from Taxi Driver? Travis Bickle, right?
Yeah.
I knew that Taxi Driver was a movie that, you know, people who love movies watch. And so I watched it in college and probably didn't have a lot of context for it. Found it to be dark and confusing and obviously recognized the iconic moments. You talking to me, right? That's that he's in the mirror. You talking to me. I'm not messing
that
up.
Oh, yeah. You know, I don't think I've ever seen Taxi Driver. So.
I don't think you would like. I mean, it's very dark, very, very gritty. And of course, he's like an absolute anti-hero in a way that I probably didn't even fully understand the first time I watched it, which is weird because it's very clear. It's very obvious. Here's what I was going to say. Do you remember when you and I used to go bowling and I would always use the bowling name Hard Rain?
Yes.
I don't know if you remember that or not.
Oh, I do.
I just thought it was funny and I'd always put it up there, Hard Rain. And I thought, first of all, this is funny. I was messing up the quote anyway. Like the quote from the movie is one of these days a real rain is going to fall. I just realized that in the past couple of years. But in my head, it was always a hard rain is going to fall. And I was like, Hard Rain, that's a tough bowling name. And I continued to use it. And now I just realized like, no, that's a quote about a maniac who is like very racist
wants to clean
and
the
wants
streets
to clean
of...
the streets. I'm just like, what? And I was bowling with my buddies the other day and I look up and it says Hard Drain. And first of all, I spell it as one word. So it sort of looks like Hard Drain, which I sort of like to pronounce it that way too. And I was like, I don't know if I want to use that anymore. And then I sort of justified it like being like, first of all, the quote is real rain. I don't even know if most people around here wouldn't. They look up, they see Hard Drain. I don't know if they even make the connection. But it started to make me feel icky. As like for years, for like my adult years, the last 15 years of my life, I've been using Hard Rain as a jokey bowling name. And now I'm kind of like, wait a second, am I celebrating Travis Bickle's awfulness?
Well, it's, I guess this is what this ultimately is a silver lining situation, which is your, I don't want to say tendency, I don't want to get in your head, but the fact that you actually misremembered the quote is really saving the bacon on this one. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like it's your, you know.
One of these days, like, a soft drizzle is going to come and water the plants.
It really takes the edge off because of not having it verbatim. So here's to that.
Here's to me being sweetly simple.
Thank you, baby. All right, let's thank some donors who are making the program possible today. Folks like Kim Kerr in Seattle, Washington. Kim is financially supporting this whole operation.
Thank you, Kim.
Thanks, Kim.
Appreciate it.
Another alliterative name. Kim Kerr.
Yeah.
Any other?
Suzanne Summers, Kim Kerr.
Any other KK, like celebrities with a first name K, last name K, who are big in the culture? Nothing comes to mind.
Krusty Clown?
That's exactly who I was thinking of.
I don't know if Krusty the Clown spells clown with a K, though.
We've got the world's expert in here somewhere in this hotel room. Hey, Bex, how does Krusty the Clown spell his name? Is it Krusty with a K and clown with a K? Oh, yeah. We've got
Oh, yeah.
Becca's family, I think I've talked about this on the show before, but they had...
Oh, yeah.
I think her brother, Jeff, would just tape The Simpsons, you know, just for years and kind of out of boredom or whatever, and, like, they just had tapes and tapes of The Simpsons and would watch them whenever they were kind of bored, and their family, particularly these three siblings, are just... I really want them to go on Jeopardy, but only for probably like about, I think, a six-season span of The Simpsons.
Uh-huh.
I'm going to really put them up against almost anyone in the world for Simpsons knowledge.
This is rough because that was a hearty laugh I got from the oh yeah, but unfortunately, according to the internet, the clown is spelled with a C.
You've embarrassed me again on the show, Rebecca. Clown is spelled with a C. It was a quieter oh shit. It just emanated from the other part of the hotel.
Now her head is spinning the way mine was at the top of the show. She has to go back and recontextualize her entire life now that she realizes clown is spelled with a C.
I'll tell you what's spelled with an M is McNamara. That's the last name of Aaron, who's in Westmont, Illinois, supporting the program. Thank you, Aaron.
Appreciate it.
Thanks also, Andrew. We got another alliterative first and last name, Stephanie J. Salmon.
Nice. Right up there with the Suzanne Struthers of the world.
Yeah. Now, there you go. Suzanne Struthers. I love it. Thanks, Stephanie Salmon in Issaquah, Washington. Also, Amy Crockett checking in from San Jose, California.
I love San Jose. I only spent a brief period of time there, but I fell madly in love with it, and I bought myself a San Jose Giants hat.
I was watching some kind of TikTok clip of a podcast, and the podcast is, I believe, co-hosted by the sports journalists Aaron Andrews and Carissa Thompson.
Mm-hmm.
I've always been very fascinated by Carissa Thompson because she's from the Northwest, and I believe her family owns an auto dealership. And so because when she was getting very famous on the national level, she was still doing the ads for the local, like, I think because it's maybe, you know, her dad's or her uncle's or like the car lot is owned by her family. So even though she's a big national sports journalist now, she would still be showing up on these, like, you know, on these local TV ads, which I just thought was great.
Cool. Yeah.
And so they have a podcast, and this is related to San Jose. I believe it was, I can't remember which one of the two it was, but one of them was saying they had just gotten done with this big football broadcast. You know, it was like a Sunday night game or something, or Monday night game or whatever. It was in the Bay Area, it was probably Levi Stadium, and that they went back to the airport, but they had a bunch of time to kill. And so they had gone to this casino near the airport in San Jose, and they had just been hanging out there, and like, kind of the joke being like, are we the kind of people who would go to a shitty casino near the airport in San Jose? And I was like, I know the exact casino you're talking about. And I know exactly the San Jose airport adjacent casino you're in, because I've been there many times.
I know where the good restroom is. I know what to
seriously
order off the,
like,
back of the
I mean
menu.
That's like, that's when people are describing something as a kind of like, what has our life gotten to that we're doing this, and you're like, that's one of the reasons I fly out of San Jose. you've got to take a moment, you've got to take an inventory. Thank you to Amy out there in San Jose. Thanks also to Wayne Kirkendall in Mill Creek, Washington. Second day in a row we've had a Mill Creek check-in.
Oh, you're right. Yeah. Also, second day in a row we've had an Amy. I mean, who was from
I'm more
from
impressed
Mill...
with the Mill Creek thing, but okay.
Yeah, I guess. But Amy was from Mill Creek, whatever. That's...
Oh, okay. Oh,
they
really?
Not all
you,
of,
I forget you
not
have all of this
all of
info.
My, not all of my comments can be winners, Luke. Not hold on. Let me recut that for the final cut of the show. Not any of my comments can
I
be
do
winners,
think,
Luke.
I do think Suzanne Struthers is a strong one, though. That was funny when you said that.
Possibly a show title.
Thanks also to Sarah Wilcox, who's in Tacoma, Washington.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sarah. Appreciate you. Thanks to all of our donors for making today's program possible. We couldn't do this without you.
Hello and welcome to Top Story.
All right, quickly, Andrew, the thing that I don't know if you've noticed this. Yesterday when we were doing a sound check, and then I guess you wouldn't have heard, you couldn't have heard after we dropped the line and I was going on with my day. But in both cases, I've been walking around this hotel room singing a song in my head. And it's because there are these big video screens everywhere in Times Square. And they're on these crazy loops. I was talking yesterday about how there's this one for this BritBox show called Archie, which is about the actor Cary Grant. It's like a biopic series. But I'm looking at it right now. All that happens is he falls backwards into a swimming pool. It's like a 5-second clip. And it's on crazy repeat. And it's like... And I was, last time I was here, or at least a year ago when I was here, I was talking about that movie trailer for Violent Night.
Oh, yeah.
Where Santa just like kicks a bunch of ass. And what I've decided that they've figured out is the average amount of time that someone will look up when walking through Times Square and how long they will fix their gaze on something, right? And the average number of people who go through Times Square. And they've done some sort of math where they're like, we have this timed out so that... Like, what they haven't designed it for is a podcaster sitting in a hotel room staring at it for 1.5 hours. Like, that's not what it's designed for. That's not the utility. And so it makes me, it drives me insane because I'm just watching this loop over and over and over and over and over again. But if I was just out for a stroll with the family in Times Square and I looked up and I see Archie falling into a swimming pool, I'm like, oh, that's interesting. Maybe I'll look that movie up or that show up, you know? Mm-hmm. So one of the things... that's on crazy repeat is some service called Linktree. I think what Linktree might do is it might be a place where if you...
Can I jump in here? I have a Linktree. Linktrees are pretty common. On like Instagram, you can only put so many links in your bio. So you put a Linktree there. And then it's like another, it's like kind of like a social media addendum sort of. So like I have a Linktree that links to TBTL, Spotless Pod, After These Messages, my Instagram, and whatever social medias I have. And you can just all put it there. Then you throw your Linktree into your Instagram bio
or your Twitter bio. I thought it was just... a link to various trees you've seen.
Yes. I mean, is that... I'm sorry to cut you off, but I kind of... No. Is that what you expected it to be?
I guess I did, but now that you say... first of all, I very much appreciate you jumping in and clarifying. And that... I guess I was thinking it was something like that, but I've also, now that I think about it, I've seen Linktree in people's bios a million times. I just never put it together. So... one of the people that's being advertised on Linktree is this guy, Brian Jordan Alvarez, who's this creator on TikTok who I really love. He does these insane characters that without the visuals, it's kind of impossible to understand what he's up to. Like, this is one that he does called, like, Your Rich Southern Aunt. And this is, like, Your Rich Southern Aunt talking about her dilemma with hotels.
Uh-huh.
Let's see here. Oh, you know what? I might have to switch this over. Sorry.
I think I've heard of this before.
Yeah. The visual, he's got a wig on when he does this, and he uses all kinds of weird filters and stuff, which kind of adds to it. But just like, hold on a sec. Let me get over to the actual
I think something people don't relate to that much, because I try to be relatable, but there are some things where I go, okay, well, most people aren't having to deal with this. Is that we are always debating when we go to a new city, because you don't know what a hotel's going to look like till you get there. And we are always debating St. Regis or Four Seasons. St. Regis. And when there's only one of them in a city, it's nice because the decision feels like it's been made for us, you know. But Four Seasons has all these benefits. And St. Regis does too. And we love the service at both places. And we just love the brand recognition, especially when you're going somewhere where you do not know, you know, what's going on. You don't know what's in the grocery store, blah, blah, blah.
By the way, I love that line for some reason. Like, the grocery store is just going to sell ice or something.
Yeah.
You know, he has this incredible ear for like just the way that people talk.
Yes.
This guy I'm obsessed with. I don't know what the hell this character is. It's a guy with like a kind of unplaceable accent. And the filter he's using is making, I don't even know what the filter is. It's like making him into a very hunky guy, but with weird proportions. And this character is just talking about going on Hinge and like the dating app or something.
Can anyone tell me what the frick
I am supposed to do on my first Hinge date? You guys, this is not sponsored content. I started to chat with someone on there. I said, where would you like to go to eat? They said, let's just talk for a little longer. So we did. I discussed how Prometheus is one of my favorite films. The opening shot, mind-blowing. And then, guess what? She said, okay, I would like to meet for a coffee. You guy, I'm so freaking nervous. I have a lot of confidence in my career. I am available to get the full-time job, etc. You all saw it happen. But now, I've got the real life in front of me. And I'm going, okay, I can do this. So, let me know if you have a bite.
He does this other guy who's, like, the filter he's using makes them look like a overly, like a combination of Droopy the dog and like a baby. Okay. But it's just like a southern guy who I guess sells cars. This is him just sitting in a park doing this guy.
Park day. Sitting out in the park, thinking and listening and learning from all the folks here, walking around, talking about what car are they going to get for Christmas. I said, come on down, we got deals. And a lot of them are ignoring me, but the ones that pay attention are going to get a better deal on one of these Nissans or Hyundais than I have given to anybody in years, y'all. Mark my words. I'm not playing with y'all. Not today. Not ever. The deals are off the charts. This is an incredible opportunity to zone in and get yourself a new car right before the end of the year. We got the new models in, 2024s. They're gonna fly off the shelves. Don't make me sell all these cars and you're gonna miss one. Okay,
bye. I mean, the thing too is, it's the character. He's not standing on a car lot. This is what I find amazing and kind of, I don't know, so appealing about all this is there's no logic to any of it. He's not in like a kind of a bad suit standing in front of like a, you know, fake car lot background being a guy. He's sitting in a random park, probably in New York somewhere, using a filter that makes his face look like a cartoon droopy baby. And for whatever reason in his brain, he just starts talking about selling cars. Like, it's so, all of it is so kind of mismatched in a way that I really love it. It's not like a bit where it's like, this is my character who does this. It's like, I'm just going to turn this camera on and go with whatever goes into my brain. Now, I'm staring at him right now, Brian Jordan Alvarez, Linktree, all together on Linktree. The problem is, Andrew, and this is where my brain is broken, Brian Jordan Alvarez, also the guy who does this. Oh, how about that? How about that for a reveal? Mm-hmm. Playing through the wrong thing. He is the guy who does the sitting song.
Sitting is the opposite of standing. Sitting is the opposite of running around. Sitting is a wonderful thing to do because you sit.
And I have been singing this song in the back of my mind for, I don't know how long we've been here now, 48 hours. For 47 of the 48 hours, I've just been singing the sitting song. By the way, he's not in the video. He's not doing the song. It's just a picture of him. But when I see his face, I hear this song and I can't. I've just been whistling it. I've been thinking it. Becca and I were jogging in Central Park earlier today, and it was just running in the background of my brain all the time. By the way, I played it for her. She had about the reaction that you have. Limited interest.
Well, my interest now has shifted.
Okay.
I mean, it's not something I can ignore anymore. You've played it so much on the show. I don't feel like I had a huge feeling about it at first, but now I do sort of get angry because it gets stuck in my head. When something like, because you played it so much on the show, now we have a lot of listeners who will call in, and I play these voicemails too.
Love those voicemails. I welcome them, and I ask they would send more.
And I always play them. You know, didn't so somebody we played one the other day where they took that tune, but they turned the song into about digging in your backyard. Digging.
Yeah, because we've done a lot of tunneling content on the show recently.
Somebody was making a salad and called in and did a salad-related version of that song. But the problem is then I carry it around the rest of my day, right?
And the body keeps the score.
The body keeps the score. And maybe you don't remember, but yesterday when we dialed up, the very first thing that you said was you were humming that song, and I swore at you. I don't know if you realized I was swearing at you or if you just thought I had a cable management issue on my side.
I think
or
I pieced it together that you were like, thanks for putting that in my head.
Basically. Yeah, exactly. The very first thing I heard, like you dialed up and I heard you going,
well, that's because it's impossible for me to sit here in my little perch and stare at this obsessive, almost Tony Orsler-esque. I think that was that his name? Tony Orsler? There was a video artist back in the day, Tony Orsler artist. Why do I do this to myself? There was somebody who did these art projects where he would do all kinds of stuff. But one of the things he did was created this video clip. This is before GIFs or things like that, but he took a video clip of Michael Jordan doing something for the Bulls, and then he somehow digitally erased Michael Jordan from the clip. And then it would just play like on this kind of like repeat, like this, like, I don't know, 5 second or maybe even glitchier kind of fast repeat. Basically, Michael Jordan, hold the Michael Jordan. And I remember seeing these pieces by him, and they were weird but very arresting. That's basically what's going on here, except in the interest of commerce. It's just these like crazy, glitchy, repetitive videos. Yeah, right. And I can't stare at them without having that song on my head, so I want to apologize. I will also mention that, probably as a joke, one of these characters that Brian Jordan Alvarez does probably does something that we now know as Chad Face. Who are you facing?
Mm-hmm.
You sent me this article from GQ written by Kate Lindsay about this phenomenon that I didn't know it had a name. And by the way, apologies to our listeners named Chad. We have a lot of great listeners named Chad. Love you all. Sorry that you're getting caught up in this, you know, in the fact that we have to give a specific name to these kinds of things. Our friends who are named Karen can really relate. But I had seen this for a long time on TikTok, but I didn't know that there was actually a name for it. And it's kind of this thing that a lot of typically younger guys are doing to try to look chiseled and hyper-masculine. Sometimes they call these people look smackers, as in M-A-X-X-E-R-S, looks maxers, like they're trying to maximize their look. And this is also, remember when I was talking in passing about that Jack Harlow song that's like, you know, I'm Vanilla Baby, but whatever. All of the guys, all of them typically white guys, because the line I'm Vanilla Baby, because Jack Harlow's white, all of the white guys that are vibing to that song and just trying to be kind of like hot in these TikTok videos are all Chad facing hard. It's a thing where you basically, and do it with me, Andrew, and the listeners can do it at home. You are trying to make it look like you have this very sort of large, pronounced, I guess we would say hyper-masculine kind of jaw thing. So I'm just going to take you through it. First, you arch one eyebrow as if you're Dwayne Johnson.
That's right. I was going to say, there was a good example of how to raise your eyebrow in this piece. It was be like The Rock.
This is also, Andrew, how I learned. I don't think I can arch my eyebrow.
You know,
is that something like everyone can do? I can't. I don't know if I can really do that. I feel like there's a mirror here. Hold on.
I feel like it's something that I do, but I can't control it. Does that make sense?
And I feel like part of the reason that it was like Dwayne The Rock Johnson's signature move is because it isn't something everyone can do. Like, it's notable, you know, that it's like he could do this really pronounced version of it. But you're supposed to arch your eyebrow like you're Dwayne The Rock Johnson. Being told something dubious. Mm-hmm. I'm just reading directly from this piece in GQ. Second, slim your nose by sucking in air.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we're all doing that now. We're all arching our eyebrow.
I'm going to pass out.
And I'm seriously already hyperventilating. I'm slimming my nose by sucking in air. And third, bite the sides of your cheeks to create two chiseled divots. And then finally, flex the muscles around your shoulders to appear more beefed up. Jeez.
Flex them up, down, what?
I don't know. Okay, so shoulders. Let's, from the top.
I mean, I'm super hot from the neck up, but I don't know what to do with my shoulders right now.
I really would like the show pick to be us trying to do this, because I just checked myself out in the mirror, and it looks like I'm having some sort of medical event. So arch your eyebrow like Dwayne Johnson. Slim your nose by sucking in air. I'm also a little stuffed up. Yes. Sorry.
Nice. This but sounds hot. Sure.
I know, aren't you? Yeah, everybody, yeah. I'm sorry if you have to pull over right now because of how hot I sound. I know it's distracting people. And bite your, create some cheek divots and then flex the muscles around your shoulders if you're more beefed up. Hold on, I'm going to do this. I'm here.
Like forward?
I look like if Jim Varney was doing an Ernest P. Worrell character, but then was run over by a steamroller.
Ernest P. Worrell?
You know, oh, just Ernest Saves
Christmas.
Oh, that's
the full name. Oh, wow.
I use his name because it matters, Andrew. Put some respect on Ernest P. Worrell's name. Yeah, Ernest, sorry. I guess I could just say Ernest, and people our age will probably know what I'm talking about. It looks like Ernest, but he got run over by a, by a steamroller. It is. How are you looking when you do it? Are you able to get a...
No,
get
I can't see myself, and frankly, I kind of don't want to. I find these instructions to be somewhat confusing. I can sort of picture it. I find it interesting because this article also sort of talked about the phases of the selfie. Like, selfie wasn't a word for you and I growing up. I don't know if I mentioned this, but I kind of grew up in the 80s and early 90s.
Is it reasonable?
Is it reasonable
for a person
to confuse
grew up-
duck face with Chad face? But, like, they mentioned in the article the kind of evolution of what people, and they talked too about how it's often women, because of the demand society puts on women to look a certain way, yeah, that like the sort of the duck face sort of started there. And then there was something that I had not heard of before, although I recognized it immediately from the description. Soy face is that look that people, yeah, do, where they sort of like open, like often women kind of open their, mm-hmm, mouth like in a look of like kind of surprise,
almost like anime-esque
a little bit. Yeah, although I have friends on my timeline who do that a lot, and I kind of didn't realize it was a thing. As soon as I read this, I'm like, oh, this is like my friend in New Hampshire. She does it. And, you know, my friend in New Hampshire, I don't know if she's doing it. I'm just picking on her. But like, there's a lot of people I could picture this immediately. And I don't know if she's doing it specifically because it's something that a lot of other people are doing or did in this era, or if she would have always done this. I can't explain what I'm saying here.
That's a good point. Also, you're totally right. It's not really anime. I was thinking of something else. Like, there's a kind of also newer version that's probably less widespread than this, where it's kind of like a people again doing almost like a cartoonish character, but this is something different. You're describing soy face.
Yeah, and again, I don't know why it's called that. If this article explained it, I don't recall, or maybe they just linked to another piece about it. But anyway, like I found this piece revealing because I was like, oh, this is something I've seen but I didn't know was a thing. But of course it's a thing, and of course it has a name, you know.
Soy boy face, also known as the Soylent grin, which is, by the way, pretty genius.
Oh, is this a different thing? I wonder if I've got this totally wrong. What I was
No. This is know your meme. Oh, okay. I think this is all soy face.
Okay.
But I think that maybe the formal name, like the fact that Ernest P. Worrell is the full name of Ernest. I think soy face and soy boy face, my guesses are the same thing.
Was I wrong to say that this is something a lot of women do? Because if it's literally called soy boy face, and when I type in soy face, the first things I see are a bunch of guys doing it. So
if you scroll down on this Know Your Meme, which is where all of the young people get their information about memes, it shows a man and some women. I don't think it's exclusively male. Maybe that's where it got its start, but I think it's you know, applies to a lot of different folks. Soy boy face, also known as the Soylent grin, new male face, new male smile, soy face, and cuck face is an internet slang term referring to a facial expression associated with men described as new male or soy boys who are photographed expressing surprise or excitement with their mouth agape. Uh-huh. Online, a variation of Wojak, referred to as soy jack, is illustrated with the open mouth smile. I think what they say in the article and what you're referring to also, Andrew, is that this particular kind of face is very associated with online content, like maybe in YouTube or other places where you're scrolling, and the thought is, oh, if this person looks like they're really having a good time and excited, you might be more likely to click on it.
Right.
Because it's an appealing thing for the tile, you know, for the YouTube tile. that it's out there in a sea of competition, and you want to see, you know, them being kind of like, whoa, is going to make you click on that.
Yeah, and also, I mean, I really had this wrong, though, because I thought this piece, which I don't have in front of me right now, the GQ one I sent you, I thought they specifically had said something about that being something that women do, like women creators and like kind of content creators and influencers and whatnot to both make it seem like something fun and exciting is going on, but also it's a way of holding your face so it's very attractive. That was what I
they
thought
don't
it
gender
was.
It, by the way, in
they
the
don't.
Article.
Okay,
I've got
yeah,
it in
this,
front of
this
me.
This is me, and I wonder if I just thought about the couple of people in my life who I've seen do this, and they happen to be women, and it does, it is a very striking pose. I think it's very pretty, but I think I was putting my own bias on this. I've totally missed what this trend was. It's soy boy, and it's supposedly, I'm reading Mel magazine, rest in peace, Luke. has
R.I.P.
a piece, soy face is real, and it's annoying. It just needs a better name. I'm trying to see how long ago this was written, but I mean, this is where things get really cringy. It's like me trying to explain the depths of current like internet culture.
Yeah, no, nobody needs that from us, either
no.
of us. But here we are.
Here we are. Sorry, everybody. I wish I could delete the last 15 minutes of this. Wait, I can.
But I think that the point that the writer in GQ, that what Kate Lindsay is kind of saying, too, is that this is something that is actually kind of started out as some sort of a joke or maybe a self-referential thing or a whatever, but it's now become kind of unironic. It's become a way that like a certain kind of typically guy tries to sort of project some sort of like what they think of as attractiveness. And I have seen this, like I said, I've seen people doing this forever and I never knew that there was a name for it. Mm-hmm. But now that I've seen myself doing it in the mirror, I'm going to start because it's incredible. It will get me some clicks.
Oh yeah, the Chad face?
Not of people thinking I look good. It'll be people thinking that I need medical attention.
Exactly.
People will be, I will be getting like medically swatted. People will be calling 911 on my behalf to get EMTs to wherever I am when they see me doing the Chad face. All right. How about a little music for your weekend before we get out of here? What would you like to play on this Friday, my friend?
What if I just Nixon part of today's show? I told you in the last second.
Oh, stop.
I've never done that before. What if I just like told you after the show, hey, Luke, I'm sorry, something happened with the tape recorder. Like a bunch of it is just deleted.
Well, unfortunately,
big chunks are deleted.
You've now ruined your, you've now blown that. I would believe you. That's how little I know about the technical aspect of the show at this point. I would be like, okay, I guess, why was he calling me Halderman? That's weird. But okay, whatever. It's fine.
Hey, that's fun. Adds a new little spice to the friendship. I don't know if this is a lazy pick or not, because I feel like whenever they come out with a new record, or I guess he comes out with a new record, we play it by Youth Lagoon. You played some Youth Lagoon a couple of months ago.
Yeah, Rabbit.
A new song came into my life via press release, I believe a couple of weeks ago, and I've had this in the queue for a while here. I don't know if you've heard this yet, Luke, but this song is called Football. I don't remember that. Is Youth Lagoon, it's mostly the project of a guy, right? Or is it
yeah.
a full band? Is he out of Chicago?
He's from originally Idaho.
Oh, okay. Yeah, Idaho.
And I
right.
think
yeah, yeah.
he went, my memory is he went through some sort of a medical thing where he was having a really, really difficult time singing. Because of like, I don't want to guess, but I remember him doing interviews about it. And it was one of those things where he was kind of not sure if he was ever going to be able to sing again, which is weird because the guy from like the band Beirut also went through that. There was a period of time where there was two different interviews on NPR with musicians who had lost their voices and then had like rebuilt their voices, and it's easy to mix them up. But the guy from Youth Lagoon did go through some version of that for whatever.
Yeah, like. Yeah. Trevor Powers, and also sometimes performs under the name Trevor Powers, but then sort of resuscitated this project called Youth Lagoon, I believe, in the past couple of years. And usually, whenever I hear a song by them, I like it. So here is one of the latest. This song is called Football.
Face was wearing thin like an old shoe sole. Mama turned to dust. She was on the train tracks waiting for blood to rush. And you told me I was staying strong when all I've done is play along. And they put it on, they put it on me. Don't put it on me. Maybe you're not the person who caught the
talking about football too much on the show lately. However, it's a groove.
Yeah, it is. I have been that, I don't have the name off the top of my head, but whatever that album is that we were talking about that came out a little while ago, a few months ago, I've been playing the living tweedle out of that. Particularly that song Rabbit that I played as a Music for Your Weekend a while ago. Oh my gosh, the song takes me on a whole journey. Very into it.
Now, this song that I'm playing for you now is not on that release, right? I'm just wondering.
I don't think so. It doesn't.
I think this is new, but
it's called Football?
This song is called Football. Yeah, maybe this is just a song that's been out for a while and they're just promoting it now. I'm not exactly sure. No, it looks like a single that just came out a couple of weeks ago. So anyway, yeah, the song is called Football by Youth Lagoon. If you like that, it's on the Spotify's.
Speaking of staying with or going with what you know, my suggestion this week is basically probably my two biggest musical obsessions over the course of the last 2 years. In fact, at Christmas time, Addie was showing me how to, this is again, a reason that people turn to us for internet analysis, because I know so much about the internet that I didn't know how to look at my Spotify Wrapped.
Mm-hmm.
And Addie had to show me how to do it at Christmas. And it turned out my most played song was by MJ Lenderman. You Have Bought Yourself a Boat.
Oh, like, yeah, yeah, right.
I love that guy. And, of course, I also love Waxahachie. I've been absolutely obsessed with that album, St. Cloud, and still am and love it very much. Well, guess what? Waxahachie has a new single out with MJ Lenderman. Mm. Two great tastes that taste great together. I believe that the Waxahachie has a new album that's going to be coming out in a couple of months, and I cannot wait. But in the meantime, the song Right Back to It is Waxahachie and MJ Lenderman. Can we hear a little bit of that? Waxahachie, MJ Lenderman. It sounds, I say this, you know, with all the admiration in the world, it sounds like a Waxahachie song to me. And I like Waxahachie songs. Like, I like the fact that the song sounds like kind of what I hope it's going to sound like, if that makes any sense.
I had a weird marijuana flashback during that song. This is a new thing. Have you ever heard of this has nothing to do with the music
at all. Wait, a flashback to a time you were enjoying marijuana?
No, I mean, I'm I'm half kidding because you'd hear about LSD.
I see. It was as if you were high and you had a flashback.
But yeah, but it's not about the song. It's just something weird happened to me. Maybe it's because we're recording a little bit earlier in the morning. I almost had a hallucination. You know how people talk about LSD flashbacks or whatever because it supposedly stays in your system? That's not really something with marijuana. So I was joking about that. But I don't know why I'm talking about this, but there's a specific marijuana strain that's been around for a while called Headband. I don't know if you've heard that in any of the music you listen to. And it got its name supposedly because, you know, sometimes if you smoke it, one might feel like they have a headband on, even though they're not wearing one.
Oh.
And this stands out to me because I remember smoking it one time and having that sensation happen to me and not realizing until later that I had been smoking something called Headband and being like, holy shit, that's really a phenomenon. I'm not going to say it works all the time, but
do they have one called Big Junk?
they have one called Chad Face. I don't know if that's going
to I'm on it right now, my dude.
That's going to get you anywhere. But I remember that, like, it's almost like it'll sometimes make it feel like you're, and I wear hats a lot anyway, like often build like baseball caps or something.
Yeah.
And so it's sometimes you'll be high on this stuff and you'll want to kind of take off your hat. And you realize, oh, I'm not wearing a hat. Like years ago that happened to me, but just sitting here, I was listening to that song. My mind was kind of wandering and then I went to take off my hat and I wasn't I'm not wearing a hat. And that's why I said I had
that's the headband. Band of songs.
I don't think that sensation I just had literally has anything to do with marijuana that I smoked in the past, but it really was like I sort of was just like listening and vibing out, and then I went to take off my hat and I wasn't wearing one.
Wow. That's very interesting.
I honestly it was a weird momentary sensation that I did not have to talk about on the show, but
I
brought it up because I thought that you might specifically find that interesting.
I do find it very interesting. I really
I feel
do.
Like that's a dazzling
get
detail
more into
could,
marijuana.
I feel like it's a dazzling detail you will share with other people. Well, have you heard of Headband?
Becca, have you heard of Headband weed?
Don't call it Headband.
Don't call it Headband weed. Have you heard of the marijuana strain called Headband that makes you feel like you're wearing a headband even if you're not? You didn't do that at University of Oregon? No? All right. 0-2 here.
Hey, speaking of you and Becca and your big trip to New York City, did you guys end up getting to jog through Central Park?
Yeah, we did it this morning.
Yeah, how was it?
It was really fun.
Wait, you did it before the show? We dialed up at 6 a.m. What time did you guys jog? At like 5 in the morning?
Well, no, because it was not 6 a.m. out here.
Oh. I'm such an idiot. I was thinking like, because we recorded an hour early. It's 9 a.m. Yeah. out here. And in my head, I was like, oh, man, Luke's really getting up early today because it's going to be 6 a.m. on the East Coast. I was doing my math wrong, obviously.
I wish I didn't disabuse you of that. I want you to think I'm that productive. No, because it's snowing here, but it's weird. It's not sticking, but it's just kind of snowing. And we were really wanting to try to get this jog in. And we're worried that tomorrow it might be not possible because of weather. We're very like being now from Portland, I'm taking every weather report very seriously now because of everything that's been going down in Portland. And I mean, it's very weird to be here in New York, a place that I think of as in the winter as being much colder and harsher weather wise. And then we're just on our phone looking at like, oh my God, look at this, trading our phones back and forth, like, look what happened in this place and this tree fell on this house and this terrible thing happened and these people have burst pipes. It's just like, you know, it sounds like a really, really tough scene. My sister's restaurant, Pollo Bravo, they keep having to close because there's so much ice, no one can get to the restaurant.
Well, at least they don't have a frozen. I thought you were going to say that they had a pipe burst. I saw some, I've never been there, but there's kind of a legendary hockey bar in Greenwood called the Angry Beaver.
I saw that
they like had some sort of made like their pipes burst open and it's caused major damage. And they posted something like, we don't even know if we're going to reopen again. And that made me really sad. Like I've never even been there. But I know it's sort of that's been around for a long time and is a beloved kind of place in the community.
Well, they got that place was notable because they basically got ahead of the Kraken thing. Like they started that bar. I'm going to totally guess here and say 3 or 4 years before Seattle got an NHL team.
Okay, so it's not a super old bar. It's
no,
like
it's not from my 20s.
Okay.
But it was cool because it was like, hey, we've got enough people that live around here that like hockey.
Yeah.
That we're going to make a hockey bar and have a funny name, the Angry Beaver. And I remember being written up a lot and people loving it. And then we got the Kraken and it was like, oh, shit, this is like perfectly timed. So to hear that they may or may not reopen is what a bummer. So, yeah, that's going down like crazy. And all of it's got me kind of skittish. We moved our flight. We were going to fly on Sunday, but now we moved the flight to Saturday night because I'm like, I have a really big work day on Monday. And I was like, we can't be at JFK Airport on Sunday night trusting that we're going to actually be able to like it's really impacting behaviors for us. Mm-hmm. And so anyway, we were out doing this little jog this morning and we were like, should we just go? So we did the whole loop. We're like, should we just go for it? Because we never know what tomorrow may bring. This is our one wild life in New York City. So yeah, we got out and got it and got a jog in this morning. Nice. It was actually quite fun.
Glad to hear.
So yeah, this is actually turning out to be a fun trip, even though the weather's a little iffy. So we're gonna go see Chris's show tonight.
Oh, nice.
Gonna go watch. If you tune into MSNBC tonight and All In, and you hear someone going woo 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 in the background, it's just me.
Is
off
this
camera?
It's been a long time since I've had cable. I know that Chris sometimes would do shows in front of like a kind of a small audience. This is not that. Are you guys just visiting?
It's a very small
stage?
Audience of me
of
and
just
Becca,
you guys. Yeah, okay,
and
yeah.
The camera guy, yeah. Probably. So, that'll be really fun. And I saw Hamilton last night. Yeah, it's been a fun kind of quick little trip to New York City. Nice. So, the listener suggestion for the music for the weekend this Friday is from listener Matthew, who says, "Hey, dummies, I'm listening to episode 4118, and you're discussing whether you want to talk about the weather or not. And this song called Weather by Lawrence popped into my head. It's an 8-piece soul pop band headed by siblings Clyde and Gracie Lawrence." Clyde actually went to D.C. and spoke in front of Congress for the Live Nation Ticketmaster monopoly hearings recently.
What side was he on?
Well, that's let me finish the sentence, Andrew. I did want to yell that, like, I didn't, but I was tempted last night in Hamilton when they finally have the duel between Aaron Burr and Alexander Hamilton. Luckily, there was no lull in the sort of singing and dancing and everything, because I was tempted to be like, who won? Like, we kind of have a sense for it in the beginning, but he is a huge advocate of bands getting paid their due from their shows. Andrew, he's on the side of bands. He's not on the side of Ticketmaster.
What I call the wrong side of history.
But anyway, that's not just me, Andrew. That's listener Matthew writing in the email. But anyway, this song is super chill and mopey and kind of fits the winter wonderland we have here in Michigan and what sounds like part of the Pacific Northwest as well. So that's what we're going to hear. The song is Weather by the band Lawrence. And that's how we're going to wrap up this broadcast week. Thank you so much for listening to TBTL. Thanks for being part of this thing. We're going to see you on Monday with more Imaginary Radio. In the meantime, stay safe wherever you are. Have a great weekend. And please remember, no mountain too tall.
And good luck to all.
A part of me will always be in love with you. There's a fire in L.A. And since you moved there back in May, I wonder, should I call to see if you're right? Yeah, you're a million miles away, but I still think of you each day and hope the weather doesn't keep you cold at night. So I won't talk about the weather. No, I won't talk. Even when the sky is gray, I'm feeling blue. And though the winds are always changing and the clouds are rearranging, a part of me will always be in love with you.
Mom, Dad, I've got a little surprise for the two of you. I think I might just buy you a 30-room mansion in Beverly Hills, California, complete with push-button phones. Look at this face. What do you see? Look at it, Dad. What do you see? What do you see? Say it. Say it.
Well, it's a face.
Yeah, but what kind of face?
Pale? Pasty? Psychotic?
No, Dad. It's a neatly chiseled, well-groomed, drop-dead handsome face. I'm gonna become a male model.
Yeah, but Chris, you can't just walk into the glamorous, high-paying world of male modeling. It takes hard work. It takes dedication. And
a semi-moderate amount of attractiveness.
Power out.